Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Prayer, please. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful day. Lord, we thank you for watching over us and keeping us safe. Lord, we just pray for our country, that we can turn things around, and we can just pray for all those that are without jobs. We pray for our men in service, Lord. And Lord, just let us have the wisdom to do what we think is best for Alamance County. In these things we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Next is public comments. Catherine Smith.
Good evening. My name is Catherine Smith, and I am the wife of the late Sidney Smith, who worked for over 30 years tirelessly and with his whole entire heart for the citizens of Alamance County, and I'm very proud to have been his wife. The organization of the Concerned Citizens was developed to address community needs and provide a voice for all citizens in this community, regardless of political affiliation, race, ethnicity, or status. It was for those who felt disenfranchised. It was also developed to celebrate senior citizens and provide for the educational exposure of our youth. We are concerned that one of our elected officials, Mr. Sutton, who is a duly elected member of this county's Board of Commissioners, is in violation of this board's code of ethics. Commissioner Sutton, we feel, is in violation of Section 2, Paragraph 3 of the code, which states in summary, members should respect their office and not behave in ways that reflect badly on it. They should treat other board members and the public with respect and honor the opinions of others, even when they disagree. Section 4, they should act as the especially, and I like that part, as the especially responsible citizen whom others can trust and respect. We, the members of the Concerned Citizens, are asking this board to follow your own code of ethics and censure Mr. Sutton, whom we feel does not reflect the opinions of this board. We care, and we are concerned about our community, not just the black community, but Alamance County as a whole. And I think my husband and my life and several hundreds of people in Alamance County and elected officials can attest to the fact we love Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next is Sidney Smith.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Sidney Smith, and I am the daughter of Sidney Smith, Jr., and I am here to announce a community forum. It will be presented by the Concerned Citizens of Alamance County. The topic of our forum will be, it's our community, and we're taking it back. The forum will address situations such as crime, juvenile problems, services for senior citizens, our educational system, and the ineffective elected officials. This will be held on Thursday, August the 11th, 2011, at the Echo Center, which is located at Ebenezer Church on 734 Apple Street, Burlington, North Carolina, 27217, and the time will be from 6 to 8. We are inviting all elected officials, all concerned citizens of Alamance County. And if I can I approach?
Mm-hmm. And I thank you, but I'm going to be out of town that whole weekend.
Thank you.
Next is Eddie Shue.
Good evening, Madam Chair.
Good evening.
I want to read one sentence and make a couple comments on it.
Okay.
While startup costs for the Wake County program total several hundred thousand dollars, Harrison says it costs a little more than $150,000 to run the program annually, referring to 2HCMG. How do we run a program that costs Wake County money and turn this great profit, quote, that we're always hearing about? Something doesn't jive, hasn't jived with me. I would like y'all to look into how much, and let's take bedding aside. We know that if you have a detainee in a bed and he cost us $57 and we're getting $62, we're making money. But I think what happens here is they are figuring unreimbursed costs. I would like to know how many we have in Alamance County and what they are. I spoke to Chief Deputy Britt coming up. Of course, he already said they have to have them anyway. But the deputies we have up there in ICE, we pay for them. He said we'd have to pay for them anyway. Okay, I don't know. But has anybody ever sat down and said, from the time we pick him up to the time we actually get that detainer on him and start making money, how much that's costing? I'm in the process of making a letter to send to different people that run this program. I have searched the internet from one end to the other. Alamance County is the only one I can find that's making a profit on 287G. Now, they make profits on their beds, but you can get 287G people from ICE to fill the beds, just like we get the federal prisoners to fill the beds. But nobody I've found yet, and this is the lowest figure I found for Wake County. WRAL done an investigation, and they said it's cost them $500,000 a year. Now, we as citizens have a right to know if or not it is costing us, and we need it without the qualifications, But you got to look at this, we need some figures that we can look down, say, yes, this is a money-making program, or no, it's not. I thank you for your time.
Okay. Commissioner's comments? Well, I think you need to talk with the sheriff, and he can give you all that information, Eddie. Because I think we...
I've got information here, ma'am, and it is not. It is exactly... Y'all supported this program, and y'all have told us, I'm asking you, this board has told us that we taxpayers are coming out smelling like a rose. Okay. I think maybe y'all are looking for it.
Well, we have looked at it, and what we saw
was nauseam.
Yeah, I think we've looked at it, and what we saw was totally different from what you just said, so in my opinion. So, any more comments?
From the commissioners?
Yes.
Oh, I think I have a couple words.
Okay. I'll go right ahead.
With all due respect, Ms. Smith, I appreciate her coming here tonight, and she has that right to do that as a citizen of this country, great country. I certainly don't think I'm in violation of any of our codes. Number one's free speech. The last I heard was an American right. I meant no disrespect. I still don't mean any disrespect, but the only people I hear that have complained have been the people that have come here as you tonight and Mr. Peterson's group and Mr. Graves' contingencies. Everywhere I go outside of this meeting room, everybody tells me, you did the right thing. You said you told the truth, even as caustic as it may be. My phone is loaded with messages at home from people I didn't solicit, don't even know who they are, that said, we support you, you keep doing what you're doing. So I just have to say, I do what I say, I don't take anything back. I don't apologize for being human. And I would just like to move on from here. I will say that I don't believe this meeting would have been planned for August the 11th. Would it have been planned had this not come about? So you had this planned beforehand, before all this broke. Okay. So if that's okay, that's good. I congratulate you for it. Stay involved, and I hope our community can make this a better community for all of us, not just certain groups. And I congratulate your efforts there. But I definitely don't think I've done anything that I apologize for. And I'm sorry if it has offended anybody, but I have to live my life and worry about the where the chips are going to fall later.
Okay, thank you.
That's all I have to say.
Commissioner?
Well, I appreciate you guys putting that together. I know I've attended one before over there at Ebenezer, and I think that's something we do need, that keep this line of communication open. I definitely see that. I was over in Beaumont this weekend and saw a mom over there whose kids got stabbed over there. And it would have been nice had somebody been there prior to them getting stabbed over there. Trying to figure how do we approach this problem, all over because one was wearing the wrong colors, and every, I think most of you know what we're talking about there. And this mom was hurting; she was hurting. And you know, I heard your comments, Tim. You know, should have stood up. And but sometimes it's tough. I mean, it's tough. You get down in certain situations, it's too hard to stand up. And this lady was broken. And what I want us to do is to work to not have this happen. And I think you're right, Tim, to bring awareness to it. But we got to work together as a community, law enforcement, we as leaders in our community. And hopefully we can sit down at this meeting on the 11th and talk about these issues and come up with some plans and not just drop it at that.
And I apologize, I'm going to be out of town. I told her that whole weekend. I'm actually, I think I'm leaving on the 11th. Yeah, I am. Any more comments? Okay, if not, we'll go on to budget amendments. Mr. Johnson, if you'll come forward, please.
Good evening, Commissioners. It's good to be before you tonight. I'm coming before you to discuss the transfers of federal drug seized monies. This is not monies that the taxpayers has given the Sheriff's Office. This is monies that we've received from our drug traffickers and our drug dealers in Alamance County. Because, of course, tight budget times, we do not have in our regular budget monies to do things that we need to do, so we're asking on four different amendments that we'd be able to use federal drug seized monies for these, and I will go over them at this time. First, as you know, the Department of Justice had given the Guilford County, Alamance County, Rockingham County, Forsyth County, and Randolph County an airplane. We were involved in it last year, and we're still involved in it. We used that plane to do surveillance on drug dealers so we don't have to have 15 to 20 officers trying to follow a car. We use it for photographing areas, maybe marijuana growing or drug houses to show us how to get in. We use it on searching for lost people, children, Alzheimer's patients, etc. And I'm asking that $10,000 be transferred from our federal drug seized monies to the line item to be able to pay Guilford County Sheriff's Office $10,000. That covers the insurance on the plane, the hangar on rental hangar at the airport, and also all the gas when we fly. Guilford County Sheriff's Office provides the pilot.
And it also, I read somewhere that it costs the county one-tenth of what it would cost without that plane. Is that true?
Greater amount than that as far as cost. Mm-hmm. The one-tenth is probably a small figure of what it would cost.
Wow.
So. And this plane is a gasoline-powered plane, and it's very economical as far as the use of this plane.
Any questions on this?
You need a motion on each one.
Yeah, I think we need
to do it separately.
Yes. Any questions on this? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll move that we accept this.
Okay. Second. Motion in a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Okay, and I should have told you this. We currently have $304,994 in our federal drug seized assets. Once we go through these four items that I'm asking, we'll still have $142,754.03 left over. And we got word today we got 30-some more thousand coming to the Sheriff's Office.
Sheriff, before you go on, are there any restrictions or directions when this money comes from this purpose to you? Do you have to do something with it? Does it have to stay in the sheriff's office?
It has to be used by law enforcement to pay for things that the county does not supply for, equipment, training, and things like the airplane, et cetera. And we have a book that what we can use it for. And, of course, if anybody wants to see it, we can show you. And they come, and matter of fact, just finished an audit, and I think we done fine, didn't we? Well, they didn't have any problem with anything. And believe me, they're strict on it. We had to line up 30-some cars that we had purchased from drug seized monies since I was sheriff. We had to line them up for them to inspect them. So they are pretty stern on the use of this money and make sure we follow the rules. Okay, second request I have is to transfer $100,000 to our vehicle line item. As you know, because of the tight budget this year, the commissioners could not allow us to purchase more than, I think, three vehicles. And really, we're way behind because for the last few years, all we've been able to purchase is two or three a year unless we use federal money.
Sure. It was five.
Was it five?
Yeah.
You sure about that?
Uh-huh.
You better check it. Well, I'm glad I could hug your neck in because I was told three and possibility of four with some money that was in the line item.
That's fine.
Sheriff, number three. Did you mean to skip number three on purpose?
Do what?
You skipped number three.
Okay. Well, I've got them in my order. I don't know which. What order?
Three is C, 20,000.
Okay, 20,000. Okay, we'll go
to that one. So right.
We'll go back to 20,000. Folks, the law, and I have it here, also allows us to use this money. And it says, shared funds may be used to pay costs for modest commemorative plaques, displays, or memorials that serve to recognize or memorialize a law enforcement officer's contribution, such as a memorial plaque or stone at a police department facility in honor of officers killed in the line of duty. I am asking tonight that the officers killed, and of course this will be a joint venture with Graham, Burlington, and the Fire Department Emergency Services here. Alamance County, over the years, has lost, as a direct result of a person's involvement in law enforcement, killed in the line of duty, George J. Massey, March 3rd, 1994. Lawrence G. Goins, July 31st, 1936. Marcellus P. Robertson, December 7th, 1938. And Jerry Davis, September 1st, 1970. Along with numerous other officers from other departments and firemen here. And I'm asking the commissioners tonight to allow me to transfer $20,000 of our federal drug seized assets to help with this memorial. The other departments are going to be putting in money, and I'm going to say this, and certainly don't mean to hurt anybody's feelings, but $20,000 is not a whole lot for the price these officers paid for this county over the years. And I'm asking that y'all allow us. We have that memorial. The city of Graham's doing a lot for us. It's going to cost $200,000+. We've already raised over $50,000. Graham Police Department is going to put in their share. Burlington Police Department says they're putting in their share to have this memorial.
I'll make a motion that we do it because
wait,
I think.
Okay.
Hold
that.
All right.
Has anybody got any questions of the sheriff?
I think he's pretty well explained.
Sheriff Johnny Dupree was killed, you know, at Cump Park Plaza years ago, and I don't know if you remember.
He was
an off duty.
Yeah,
that
he was an off duty job.
Yeah, I
he
just wanted to make
killed
sure
in the line of duty.
Yeah.
This is for any emergency service worker, law enforcement officer that's killed in the line of duty. And I'm telling you, we've had quite a few that have died in the line of duty as far as officers and firemen.
Well, he was doing police work. That, to me, sounds like the line of duty.
He was hired.
Yes, sir. I understand.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was off duty.
Because he was protecting Cump Park Plaza.
Yep. And he was hired by them.
Well, that was tragic. I live in that area, and some people had broke into Eckerd's.
Yep.
And one of them had left a bicycle, the best of my memory.
That's
I think
correct.
I'm right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and one of them came back. They came back around to get the bicycle, and Dupree was back there. Yeah. They just
shot
executed
him.
It. It was terrible.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure that was left out in the version.
Thank you.
And now I will entertain
all right.
the motion.
There you go. We'll make that motion.
I got a motion.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Now we'll go to the $100,000.
Okay. I'm asking that $100,000 be transferred over so we can purchase four more law enforcement vehicles. We're so far behind, we're paying more money on maintenance of vehicles. We have several over 120-some thousand miles, and folks, That's dangerous, and it's also certainly not economical when we talk about maintenance of these vehicles. But as you know, we almost lost two officers when I first came in office in 2002 that turned around on a burglary suspect in the front end come out from under the car. And one had to retire.
Yeah, how about having you talking in the audience, please?
One of them had to retire medically, and the county paid a lot more money for those hospital bills and retirement than they would for vehicles. And this is drug money that has been taken from drug dealers.
Any questions?
And now, this will replace cars. I mean, you got to pull some out of your...
Yes, sir. We had a one of our K-9 cars burn up, and we got to replace, actually got to replace... four K-9 cars that we're doing with the now that finally I've got five
now
vehicles.
Got more
and I remember, y'all remember he said five.
We're going to check to make sure.
I knew that was coming.
We're going to check to make sure.
And we're going, when we replace four, we've got really four Crown Vics that is a sole supplier right now because all 2,000 Crown Vics are gone, police packages. We found four down in Vic Bailey in South Carolina, and once this meeting's, if it is approved, we're going to do the purchase orders and get there and get them before they get rid of them because we told them we had to have them, and we do have to have them. I'm telling you, we got, have y'all seen our cars riding around with no paint on them or the paint blew off? Good job.
Tell them to slow down. They're driving too fast.
I heard a certain police officer he didn't like to be seen in that car. I don't know who he was, but that, I heard that.
They can look bad as long as they'll run and don't hurt, get any of my officers hurt. That's what I care about.
Any questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
I have a motion to accept.
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Okay, due to the budget cuts, we are also appearing before you tonight asking that we can spend federal drug seize monies, transfer it over to the right line item, which is our federal drug seize forfeitures approved purchase, $32,240. This is for 260 jackets for our law enforcement officers in the Alamance County Sheriff's Department.
This is a new kind of jacket they're going to be getting.
Well, some of them don't have jackets.
Oh.
I mean, I'm not being funny. It's true. And each one of the jackets is a unit price of $124.
Any questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
I have a motion.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Once again, this is not taxpayers' money. This is drug dealers' money.
Thank you, sir.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Next, we go to county manager's reports, and we're going to talk about advertising costs.
Okay. Thank you very much, Madam Chairman. With respect to advertisements that the board has asked me to look at our last meeting, this is not as simple as it turned out to be. We as a county spent over $44,000 in advertisement last year, with the majority of that being for legal ads and for tax liens, and that makes up 66% of our total expenditures for advertisement. Just kind of a FYI, the Times News has a daily circulation of 34,000 weekdays circulation. Alamance News has a circulation of 6,400 weekly, and the Mebane Enterprise has a circulation of 17,000 weekly. And again, those numbers may be a little off, but that's what I got off the internet or found, you know. So the
1,700 from Mebane Enterprise, I think.
Yeah.
Well,
70,000. Well, that, Jackie's here.
Yeah, that was definitely off then. So, with that being said, I would like to suggest that we bid out our legal ads and our delinquent tax notifications to all three papers. These are statutorily required, but are not time sensitive as other advertisements. We would send out bid requirements to all three papers and be specific about the ad size, the font size, those type things, and making sure that we're comparing apples to apples. Public hearing and meeting announcements make up about $4,000 of our expenditures, and we will continue to do this with the Times News as we always have, since they are the only daily paper, and these ads are time sensitive, so sometimes it's very difficult to go back and figure in publication dates and those type things, it's very easy just to call and say, hey, we need in the next day. Also, our job openings, and we do not advertise much with respect to job openings, but we would suggest that we bring that with the Times News, since they have a larger circulation base than both the weekly papers. Other public service announcements will be left up to the discretion of the departments to advertise where they think they can get their best bang for the buck in reaching their target audiences. I'll ask that departments relook at how we advertise to ensure that we're using these dollars effectively and to see if there are other creative ways to get out information to the public.
I have a couple of comments. It is confusing, Craig, and I've looked at this from time to time in a former position I had as well. I asked the Times News to send me their circulation numbers. I have those. This came directly from the paper. I also have the paid circulation data from the Alamance News and the Mebane Enterprise, and I'd like to just to distribute that so that you and everybody can look at it.
Can we hand that out for you?
Yeah, I've got actually. Let me keep one. I've got three sheets. One that summarizes the information from the weekly papers, and then this is 2 years of the daily paper. Because the numbers you just quoted are different, very different from that, and that came from the paper themselves. The papers themselves. And I guess the reason that I'd like to discuss it a minute, or at least have you guys look at it, is we need to look not only at the cost, but the coverage, and what are we really getting?
The effectiveness of the ads.
Yeah, for the dollars that we're paying. And I've got a 2-year trend there on the weekly papers, and then there's two different sheets that show the same time period for the Times News. The number, for instance, for the daily paper that you mentioned, it looks like you may have added the Sunday paper with the Monday through Saturday, because they do have a Sunday distribution that's actually considerably different. So I submit that for your information and for us to kind of know that there's really two sides of the equation, not just the cost and what we bid, but the coverage area and what we're getting for each dollar that we're sending out. And I just...
Is the ad only run one day, one time?
Most ads do. Some of the employment ads may run more than once, depending upon if we get the applicants or not. Sometimes I think, and this is why it was very difficult to compare apples to apples, you would get special discounts if you ran three consecutive days for like a public service announcements for paint and pesticide at the landfill. You know, the first day may be X, but then you get a break the next 2 days if you run it for three consecutive days. So it's very confusing sometimes, again, to compare apples to apples on this. And Amy looked at bills, and we couldn't tell a trend line or tell how each one was doing it similar or different. It was confusing.
Now, Tom, this says for a 6-month period too. So
the one from, yes, but it's
that's average.
It's the average though.
It's average circulation time. For 6 months.
That's right. But it's comparing apples to apples. Yeah.
I'm just wondering if
yeah, that
should double that.
No. That's okay. The average per week for
it's
that time.
Average,
period.
Not total.
But you would compare, for instance, on the Times News sheet, the 2009 number, the 20,000 compared to the 2010 number of 18,000.
Right, which we know went
down. Weekly average. And the Sunday paper.
Oh, I know it's expensive. All real estate ads are very expensive. Any comments?
One thing to let you be aware of as well, we are not double advertising. I think that was a concern also that the board had, is that we were putting two advertisements in two separate papers to meet statutory requirements. We weren't doing that. Like this year, we did advertise in Alamance News and also the Times News for our tax, delinquent taxes. But it was like five townships in the Times News and then five or six in the Alamance News. So it was split up. We didn't have to double advertise anywhere, but that's where those differences were as well.
But if you put it out to bid, that'll take care of that also, won't it?
If we put it out to bid, hopefully you will get a better cost for doing, you know, more pages.
As long as you put specifications with it also as to what you're expecting.
To be very honest, if we looked at the tax advertisement, and I'm not picking on the Times News, but it was the truth, this year the font was about 5. The font was way smaller than we thought, and at least on the proof, and it was very difficult to read. So we would be very specific about font size and about information to make sure that we are comparing apples to apples.
Yeah, I think that would only be fair to send out what we expect
right.
from them prior to looking at it.
Right. It was different than the proof when we got back. So once it was out there, then it was out there. So.
Well, and I'm not suggesting that this analysis come back to the board for approval. That's your all's work. But,
right.
But I do think when you get the bid, you also need
right.
to look at what you're getting for the dollar spent.
Yeah. Right.
Per capita.
Right.
Exactly.
Okay.
So we need to start a newspaper, you know what?
Yeah.
With these numbers.
Any more questions?
No offense, Tom.
Okay.
Madam Chair, I do have one other announcement, if I could.
Sure.
Just an update on the courthouse reopening. Again, a lot of thanks to the Downtown Graham Merchants Association and also Brian Hagan, our Recreation Department, and Tim's done a lot of work on this as well. We're looking at having, you know, as advertised and sending out invitations, our grand reopening on Saturday, September 10th. From 10 a.m. to 11, and then we will have tours of the courthouse open until about 12:30. This will be part of the Downtown Merchants Association Let Freedom Ring celebration for public safety and military. So they're having a lot of events going on downtown at noon. Ours will be right before that. They very much wanted us to be part of their celebration. And luckily, we were able to work it out to have everything coordinated. And again, appreciate our staff's help on that also. So that's the date we're looking at. And if the board's okay, we will send out the invitations as we did before the fire in the next couple of days.
Okay. You need a consensus on that?
If that's fine. Yes,
that's
ma'am.
Good.
I'm fine.
That's good.
Okay, we go now to the consent agenda. I do want to pull out some of the resolution requests and read those if it's okay.
That'd be good.
And if we have anything else after that, then we'll pull that if you guys want to pull anything. The first one I want to pull out is the resolution requesting the assistance, and it's actually Lakeview, it's I. Resolution requesting the assistance of the Alamance County Delegation of the North Carolina General Assembly. Whereas the residents of the Lakeview subdivision have expressed to the Alamance County Board of Commissioners their concerns regarding the condition of their public roads, and whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners on August 17th unanimously adopted a resolution of support for the residents of Lakeview subdivision and any subsequent request to have their roads accepted into the secondary road system. And whereas Alamance County has been advised that funding may be available from the state of North Carolina to do necessary repairs to allow for some or all of the roads within the Lakeview subdivision to be accepted into the secondary road system, be it therefore resolved that Alamance County Board of County Commissioners, for the reasons given, hereby respectfully request that the delegation representing Alamance County in the North Carolina General Assembly, the Honorable Representative Dan Engel, the Honorable Representative Alice Bordston, and the Honorable Senator Rick Gunn, pursue funding to make necessary repairs to allow acceptance of some or all of the roads within the Lakeview subdivision into the secondary road system. This is the 18th day of July, 2011. And I have been out there and rode around, and it is bad. Jason took me out there and liked to bounce me all over. The potholes are... I can't even expand. They're so huge out there. Had many calls from out there. So We don't know what this is going to get, but we do want to send this to Raleigh.
Are there recorded road maintenance agreements out there?
No.
None at all?
No. And this is the problem, because it was built and then they had problems with their sewer and all the lots were not sold. So it is bad, but anyway, this is the request that we'd like to come up with. Any questions on that? Okay.
I think they need it.
Yeah, they do. The next one I want to do is the Firefighters Week. This is a proclamation for Firefighters Week, September the 11th through the 17th. Whereas fighting fires is one of the most hazardous professions, requiring physical strength, stamina, extensive training, courage, and selfish concern for the welfare of others. And whereas firefighters provide valuable services to the citizens of North Carolina and their communities. And whereas firefighters make sacrifices to protect the lives and of the citizens of Alamance County. And whereas firefighters respond to emergencies without hesitation when the call of duty arises. And whereas firefighters reside in the community in which they serve and have a great appreciation for protecting their communities. And whereas the North Carolina General Assembly adopted a resolution on May the 17th, 2011, encouraging citizens to observe the week of September the 11th through the 17th as Firefighters Week. And whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners support this action by the North Carolina General Assembly and agree that our firefighters deserve to be recognized and honored for their duties and services performed. Now, therefore, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners proclaim the week of September the 11th to the 17th as Firefighters Week in Alamance County, North Carolina, and encourage all of our citizens to recognize and observe this week in honor of firefighters, adopted this 18th day of July, 2011. And then I think that's the only two that I had on there. Has anybody else got
any? How about the authorization of the sale of the real property?
You want me to do that one?
Yeah. Just tell where it is. We might find some bidders in it.
Resolution authorizing the sale. This is from Jay. Resolution authorizing the sale by sealed bid of approximately 3.856 acres of real property located at 717 North Park Avenue, Burlington, North Carolina.
This is the OE Enterprise building.
That's what that is.
We talked about it later.
Yeah. We originally were going to have a public hearing on that request at this meeting. However, the banks required that it be done under bid.
Under bid.
Okay. So we had to pass a resolution.
They wouldn't accept
the reversion
clause.
Okay.
For private sale. And without that, we have to have a sealed bid.
Okay.
One of the four ways.
I thought that was what that was, but I wasn't positive. So, yeah.
So who wouldn't accept the reversion?
The bank would not finance the purchase of the improvements to the building with a reverter clause. Under the statute, if the county sells the property to a individual private sale, a corporation, or a nonprofit, it has to be a reverter clause. Requires that any subsequent sale is to a nonprofit or it refers back to the county.
Right. Well, I understand that, but tell me what changed.
We couldn't.
You couldn't do the reversion clause with a
reverter clause.
Okay.
We could have done the sale, but not do the clause.
So, in other words, now it's open for anybody to buy it.
So that's why we elected to go the sealed bid route.
So we still
can sell the property
and still have the reversion clause.
No, there won't be a need for a reverter clause because now the public can come in and bid on it. And then this board will be choosing the highest, most responsible bid.
Okay, what about the concern that the folks had about the use for the property? When we first heard that OE had an interest, was some concern passed along that if they leave, we would lose the services that they provide. So that is a very real risk.
Right. That's yeah.
Well, they need to finance the building to put air conditioning in and make improvements to it, and they can't do it unless they own it. So this is the only way they can own it legally.
Well, they can bid on it. The people that want to.
Yeah, anyone can bid it on it. We'll put a notice in the paper.
Yeah.
So anyone will be invited to bid on it.
Oh no, I understand that, but the question is, if they bid on it and win it.
I see where you're coming from with that.
The concern, this used to be a service that was provided before it was privatized, before it was outsourced.
Well, they'll just own the building, as I understand it. And they are here today. They're tonight. They're here to answer any questions you may have. But I think they're going to still provide the same service. Only this time they'll have an air conditioning and a good roof and a building for these people to work in. That's the goal.
No, I understand all that, and I'm not questioning their motives. But the fact is, if it's owned privately, they can make the economic decision to leave at some point, and we don't have the property.
That's right, but we'll ultimately be selling the property, which is, right now, it's not in the best condition. Most of it's in a railroad right-of-way, and what's not in the railroad right-of-way is in a Duke Power right-of-way. So it's up to the board to decide if they want to sell it. This is just a mechanism.
Yeah, I guess that's what caught my attention, because this is not really what we had discussed earlier that we would.
We talked about a private sale with a reverter, but that won't work because no one will finance it.
Okay. So we just have to put it out for bids.
That's the only alternative.
It's the only choice.
It's the only choice. Okay.
Well, or continue to have it operate as it is now.
Right. But the county has no money to put in to improve it.
And they can't improve it without a loan.
They can't borrow money on it unless they own it. So it's a difficult spot.
Well, I understand that, but I still am wondering what happens if they buy it and leave.
Well, if they buy it and improve it, they can sell it.
We just have to look for another place for our services.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's maybe, I think the gentleman has maybe a comment.
Yeah, please.
We've been operating for 20 plus years, for five or six. I'm Roger Francis. I'm the CFO at OE Enterprises. Mm-hmm. And we've been operating for 20 plus years in numerous counties. Alamance for probably the 5 or 6 years. I believe there is some concern because we did close our facility in Caswell, but we moved those people to Alamance. Our intention, we had problems with the facility in Caswell as well. There were some pigeons in an unused portion of the building that was creating some health issues, so we had to vacate the premises. It was a little more economical for us to move the people to Alamance. We are serving the people from Caswell in Alamance. It is our mission to serve people, okay? We serve in excess of 600 people at any given time. We are still operating in Caswell. We have community-based citizens there that are working in Caswell, and we support them with personnel that are working from their houses in Caswell, but they do report to Alamance. We have every intention to remain in Alamance and serve as we have for the past 20 years. We don't intend to vacate. It's just the economics of the transaction that required to occur this way.
To do it this way. Yeah. Okay. Okay.
You have my promise that as long as I'm employed at OE Enterprises, we're not going anywhere. It's too big of an operation to vacate.
And it is an asset to Alamance County to have it here for the citizens that use that.
It is.
Do that. I agree.
We employ probably 60 staff, and we help within the facility, we help approximately 100 disabled individuals. Not to mention the community-based individuals that we support in Alamance County. I can get those numbers for you if you'd like.
Well, I mean, we really don't have much alternative to dealing with it because he can't stay there with leaking roof and air conditioning and stuff not working.
Currently, we're renting air conditioners on a temporary basis to air condition half the building, and we've moved everyone into half the building. The working conditions are not optimal, but we're making do with what we can.
Thank you.
In the present situation.
Well, I've had a number of calls from folks involved with the local management entity and other areas of mental health that have expressed great concern about this. And I would prefer that you have a meeting with them and make sure they're okay with what your plans are and what you're doing, because this is very, very different than what I was led to believe we were going to do. So is this a resolution or a vote or what?
Well, I'm going to ask for a vote to approve the consent agenda.
Well, How soon will we have to do this out to bid? I mean, I hate to delay it, but I understand what Tom's saying, too.
I mean, I think we owe those folks an audience. They have some grave concerns about the viability of OE staying in Alamance County. And I didn't create that concern, but if that's what we're being told, I think we owe it to that group to at least let them hear these folks and what they have to say.
What is our time here?
Well, if the board approves the resolution, there's a time frame where we have to put it out for sealed bids. And we have in the resolution that we would accept them up until August 24th at 12 noon, mm-hmm. at which time the sealed bids will be opened and the report will be given to the commissioner by September 6th, at which time you can decide whether you want to accept the highest, most responsible bid or not accept.
Okay. That sounds fine. I mean, they'll know about it, Tom.
Oh, they already know about it.
Oh, okay.
But they don't like it. But they haven't had an audience with the company, and what we were told by staff was up until tonight that there would be reversion. So the rules are being changed. I think that audience deserves the chance to meet with these folks.
Mr. Manning, we have reached out to the ARC to have a meeting with them. Unfortunately, it was with our site director here in Alamance, and he's had a family emergency. So he's not available at this time, but I will personally reach out to the ARC.
Well, it's not just them.
Okay. Well, the LME as well.
Can we not table this so we can...
pull it off.
Yeah, I'm not going to ask a bunch of questions up here that make me feel like an idiot and asking them, and there's a lot more I want to know about it. You can do about anything. If you're innovative enough, there's things that we can do to protect ourselves as well as their interests. If we're innovative enough, and I don't think I'm not ready to vote on anything right now.
Well, we can pull it off of the.
Well, we can table it for
until the next meeting.
Yeah. I'll make a motion that we table that particular item.
Okay, have a motion.
I second that. Second. I think that's smart.
Okay, we're going to pull that off, and it will be put on the next meeting agenda. Okay. 2 weeks.
August.
Was that enough time?
I mean, I think 2 weeks is enough time to meet with those.
I'll get the answers I want in 2 weeks. I don't know about anybody else.
That's what I'm saying. I think that should be enough time for them to meet with them. Is that? Enough time.
We'll do our best.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Okay, we're going to pull that one off. And are any more questions about the consent agenda?
One more.
Okay.
We had a lot on here tonight. Elimination of benefits for future part-time employees. Let's hook up here and see what this might save our county.
First.
Good evening. What I've got before you is just a request. We talked about this with the personnel committee. It's actually been a while since we talked about this, but this is basically to eliminate benefits for part-time employees. We have part-time temporary employees who currently do not get benefits, but we have permanent part-time employees who do receive benefits. The benefits they're receiving that we're looking at eliminating are vacation leave, sick leave accrual, and holiday pay. This creates a real scheduling challenge for department heads who have these part-time employees, have to deal with their own employees' vacation, sick leave, and holiday time, and then have to turn around and find it for these part-time people as well. And then the cost of this is about $40,000 a year. We would not propose that we get rid of the benefits for the employees who are already here, since we sort of hired them under that agreement. But we would say for any future part-time hires, they would come in without those benefits.
I think the government needs to do just what she's suggesting. We owe it to the taxpayers.
And as Sherry said, it's a scheduling nightmare when you have to schedule off part-time and furloughs and holidays. What we're basically looking at, part-time is part-time. You get, if you work 10 hours, you get paid for 10 hours and no benefits.
It's part-time, and they just with it.
Okay.
Thank you, Sherry. We can put that back on as far as I'm.
Okay. Anything else that we need to address in the consent agenda? If not, I'll entertain a motion to accept the rest of the consent agenda.
So moved.
And we'll put that back on.
Second.
On favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? No. No one opposed. Commissioners' comments now. Any commissioners' comments?
I never got criticized for something I did not say. I'm not going to say anything.
What'd you say?
I've been working on it. I never got criticized for something I did not say.
So you don't have anything
to say. There you go. That's good.
Are there any announcements?
Well, I did tell the guy at Starbucks the other day I was going to try to stay quiet for 30 days, see if I could stay out of trouble. He said, you can't do it. He's probably right.
If there are no announcements, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.